Hi everyone, thanks for coming.
Yes, thank you all for participating.
We're going to do a lecture first on human behavior and depression. It's about 44 minutes, and then we'll take questions along those lines. So thanks again, and we'll get started.
Okay, today we're going to talk about depression, feeling low, useless. Feeling that you can't do anything about some particular problems, whether they're personal or social, or you're not included in participation. What is depression, first of all? Depression is based upon, in most cases, looking for justice or looking for positive answers. And you can't look for positive answers unless you know what to look for. If the average person tried to build a bridge, a real bridge, they could not participate because they don't know the math, they don't know the formula, and they don't understand the problems. The same with depression. When a person feels depressed and somebody says, "Why do you feel depressed?" They don't know, they just feel depressed, because they don't have the tools to work themselves out of that. Now I'm going to talk about the tools. If you were to ask the average person how big the pontoons have to be on a seaplane of a given size, they don't know. They will run a loop saying, "I don't know. I don't think I can do about the seaplane." The same with depression. When you don't have answers to those problems, you go around in loops. You always feel depressed. Now there's verifiable depression, such as a loss of a loved one, or a dear friend, or a particular stress when you're told that you have cancer and you have a short time to live. There should be a depression, yes. But if you're in good health and you don't feel that life is passing you by, you might become depressed because you feel that you're useless, or a low self-sufficiency, or you don't know what to do about it. So depression is usually caused by lack of information or tools to overcome the problem. If you can't do anything about it, if there's an earthquake and your friends are killed, it's normal to feel depressed for a certain period of time. If the depression extends, it means you don't have tools to deal with it. The tools to deal with it is, what can you do to prevent earthquakes or diminish it? Convert your depression to some constructive attitude. If you don't know how to do that, look up information on constructive attitude. Constructive attitude is doing something about it. Therefore, the feeling of depression, the feeling that you can't do anything about certain conditions, the feeling that you're not useful to yourself or society, all of these indicate improper information. All depression is based upon the inability to handle certain problems, having no tools to deal with those problems. If you have the tools to deal with the problems, it goes something like this. If a tree falls over and you say, "Gee, that tree has been there for years, that's a shame. Plant a new tree, or straighten up the old tree," if that bothers you. If you can't, you've got to accept it as part of natural occurrence. If you get ready for a picnic and it's raining or cold out, you feel your life has been interfered with. That's your own projection. Whatever happens is real. What you think should have happened is what depresses you. So it's your expectations that depress you. I put out a certain amount of effort toward that person and they left me. That means that you had expectations. So what depresses you is your own limited information, your own sense of projection, your own sense of values. When I say your own sense, I mean the values that you pick up in your society. So really, what is missing? The same thing that's missing when people ask you to design safe automobiles. No matter how much you think about it, you don't know enough about it to provide safety devices. You don't know how to put proximity devices on cars. You don't know anything about it. So therefore, you go around in loops. Oh my God, it's been a terrible accident. I wish I could have been there. I wish I could do something about it. Those words do not solve problems. What solves a problem is, do I know enough about the subject to ease out of it? The answer is no. If an airplane were to have a bad landing and a lot of people are injured and you're depressed, the next question is, could you do anything about it? No. So the depression remains. If you can do something about it, make better tires, safer tires for airplanes, that's converting depression to an action pattern. If you just feel depressed, it means you don't have the tools to pull out. That's all it means. So, if a nation goes to war, and you send your son to war, and you hope he doesn't get killed, that may depress you. But what they really want is no war. You don't want conditions that will produce depression. So you join an organization to fight those conditions, to alter those conditions. If you do nothing to alter the conditions, nothing will happen. Now, even if you do something to alter the conditions, if the something that you do is too different than the nature of the culture, it will not be adopted. If you go to the army and say, why don't you guys study public health and how to improve relationships with other nations? The army says, we have. No, they have within their concept. You have to invite the other nations. What do you consider a constructive compromise? Not you going in saying, you got to think like we do. You can't solve problems that way. You can't walk into another country and say, take down the Pope, take down Catholicism. They're not about to do that. That's a request that's unattainable. Now, if you wish to grow food without spraying pesticides on the food, well, there's nothing you can think about. If you don't know that sound can keep certain insects off food, you have to know the answers to various problems. That's the way you solve depression. What depresses you is your expectations, not necessarily the real world. So most people that become depressed do not have the tools or the answers to questions. They either feel they're rejected, they liked a certain person, but the person did not return that feeling to them, or you're in love with somebody, but somebody doesn't love you. Well, there's a lot of people you don't like that you reject, but you don't think about that. So you've got to remember that different people have different standards. If they like you, they may have parallel values. If not, they would not like you. It's normal. Now, it's very rare that a Nazi family will adopt a Jewish baby because they have certain sets that interfere with that. And if they did adopt a Jewish baby, if it misbehaved in some way, say it's probably because they're Jewish. See, that's the only type of rationalization. Or if you go out with an Afro-American and somebody says, well, you're going out with a different kind of person, you should go out with your own kind. Sooner or later, everybody will hurt you in some way or another. So you say, that's that damn African-American. It's that damn Filipino. It's the damn Jew. Or it's a damn Italian. Everybody does things at times that you don't like, including yourself. You do many things that you don't like. But if you do too many things that you don't like, it means you're on a track that isn't relevant. That is, it is your background. You have no way of thinking your way out of it. So that is study of behavioral science. It has nothing to do with present-day psychology. Behavioral science concerns itself with the factors that shape your behavior. Now, if the behavior is shaped by toxins or poisons, that's something else, entirely different. If the behavior is shaped by brain damage or physical injury, where you can no longer walk and you want to walk or you want to get around, if you don't have the money for a wheelchair, then you have to work out solutions within the conditions that you're in. Either you don't get around with a wheelchair, or you get books, or have somebody get books for you that you might be interested in, or you work on activities within your range. Or, If you're living with pain that's so severe, you may want to end your life. That is not unreasonable if you can't get medical care. And a lot of people do. They get into so much trouble in their lives due to the value system they have, which they picked up from their culture. Their value system does not offer solutions to their problems. So life becomes painful. And they decide to take their life because living is too painful. That's because they don't have alternatives to turn to. The more alternatives you have, the lower the probability of depression. So depression is not a psychological condition. A manic, sometimes they feel high, very high, sometimes they feel very low. What psychology does, and psychiatry, is invent a label for you that does not describe the condition. When you call a person schizophrenic, are they schizophrenic because people in their neighborhood threaten them? If you live in an Italian neighborhood and you're not Italian, the most Italians will boycott you, or that is, if they're brought up that way. They won't behave pleasantly toward you, and so you feel that everybody's against you. They are in your neighborhood. Sometimes it's real. Everybody was against every new idea, the liberation of women, the freedom of the slaves. There was always somebody against it. But if you're a minority and you advocate a program that's not possible within the limits of that society, then you have to accept that that society is too far backward to understand that change. Or if you go in with great enthusiasm and great belief and they still don't understand, you might say, well, what's the matter with those people? Nothing's the matter with those people. They've been indoctrinated for years against Filipinos, or against Afro-Americans, or against Swedes, or Jews, or Polacks. The society you live in gives you a set of values that's somewhat appropriate for the success of some members of that society. It has nothing to do with your own life. So they program you to fit within that society. But if you really don't fit within that society, you may get depressed because you don't know who you are, or what you stand for, or what kind of contributions to make to society. You feel you're a failure. All failures are people that have inappropriate information. Now you'll have to ask questions like, what is appropriate information? Information essential to the conditions you live under that will help you out of those conditions. Such as, if you plant a group of flowers and they freeze, you like flowers, now you're hurt because you lost the flowers. But there is a possibility of covering those flowers so they are not subject to the freeze. But if you don't have the tools to do that, you will encounter problem after problem, all problems except physical diseases, which you can get, which can torture you, torment you. That's the reason that people take their lives. They have no way out of that. They don't know how to control that. And if doctors don't know how to control that, the decisions you make are best based on what you know and how much pain you feel. If we can devise a system which is called chemotherapy, chemotherapy is using drugs to make a person feel good. That is not based on a value system. When the drugs wear out, you feel depressed again. So you have to take the drugs. Rather than drugs, what you really need is a process level for understanding what it is that depresses you and what tools you lack. So you have to seek out the tools, the methods of solving those problems, not taking drugs as an antidepressant. You can make a person feel relaxed. But until the chemical wears out, because there's not a change in the values. People that use such systems are really doing inappropriate research, unless you use that system temporarily until the person becomes better informed. Unless psychology alters your values and points out other ways of living which are not inherent in your social system, then you become aberrated to other people. You appear very different. You don't fit in. If you learn a new way of thinking or a different way of thinking, or let's say you're a peacenik, one that advocates peace in a nation at war, the nation thinks you're subversive. you're hurting the war effort and you feel depressed. Only if you know what you're saying is true, you feel sorry for the other people that use force. Instead of feeling depressed, you feel sorry for the people that kill soldiers. Do you understand? You only feel depressed when you're not sure of your beliefs or your acceptance. If you believe you can build a flying machine and everybody says you're nuts and you feel depressed about that, it means you're not sure of your own convictions. If you know you can build a flying machine, you don't depend on what people say. If you believe that all people should have equal rights, and most people don't believe that, you feel sorry for the other people and you try to change them. And if you can't change them, you say, I don't have the ability to change them. But feeling depressed means you expected some change because you delivered some effort and logic. You only get from other people what you get from them, not what you hope to get. Do you understand that? So feeling disappointed in people must be disappointment in your own expectations, not the other people. They're consistent with their background. We're going to talk about behavioral sciences and many different action patterns that people have. But this is the basis that I'm giving you. Without the sunny day in May, those of you that don't know what that means, I wanted to know as a kid how airplanes fly. And I took a book out on the Wright brothers. And it opened with, it was a sunny day in May, and Mrs. Orville Wright was hanging clothing on the line. I did not want to know that. I wanted to know how airplanes fly. So the most books you read have a lot of sunny day in May and very little information. Of course, writers get paid by the amount of words they put out. So you got to think about that. And sometimes people don't have information. They say, if only people would be kind and considerate and learn to live in peace and harmony with one another, we wouldn't have war. Well, how do you do that? That's the problem. What you think sometimes is the words that you hear. If only people become considerate, kinder, deeper understanding. Without elaboration, nobody knows what you're talking about. So people agree with the conclusions. We've got to be kinder, understanding, but nobody knows what understanding means. If you don't understand yourself, you can't understand other people. Understand means accept the things you cannot change, know where to look to promote change in some people that are ready for it. There are many people that will not change, that cannot change due to their heavy indoctrination. So you've got to understand when you meet with people, you give the best that you can to help them understand. If they fail, it may mean that your delivery was not relevant to their values, or that they've been too heavily indoctrinated to accept what you say. You don't know that, so you don't come at it with, I'm sure I can get you to understand me. You can't be that sure, unless you know everything about them, and very few people know everything about anybody else. People will revert back to their way of thinking because they have no other tools. When you come at them, you're giving them new tools which they may not fully understand. If they fully understand what you're talking about, they will begin to practice saying, I don't know, but I'm going to try. And when you try and it doesn't work, you become discouraged. Remember, whenever you try anything, art, painting, sculpture, if it doesn't work, you become discouraged, rather than knowing that the instructor was unable to get the information to you, or you don't have enough background to make that leap, or that you don't have enough understanding to move in that direction. Even though you wish to become a flyer, and you get in an airplane, and you can't keep that airplane straight, and the pilot says, you'll never be a flyer, you have no good sense of balance. He is not imparting information to you, he's imparting the results of your inability to fly. But information is checking with the horizon line and closing your eyes and to tell the person when the chair is tilted to the left or right, practice. And then you can pretty much say, I feel too much pressure in the right part of the buttocks or the left part of the buttocks. That's what the guy does that knows how to fly. He may not know how to transfer that to you. He says, you just don't make a good pilot. You don't have the ability. Those are no information words. It's a feeling you get when a plane's flying at an angle. You feel different pressures. You don't pay attention to those. You pay attention to, I can't keep this airplane straight. People don't know how to transfer information. Now, even if you're not sensitive to that, you can be put in a dummy cockpit and tilted and learn to say, I think I'm nearly upright because the pressure's even on the right and left side of my body on the chair. You can be made aware of things you're not aware of, assuming the person doesn't have paralysis of the nervous system. Of course, you use your eyes, but you also use other systems. If you blindfold a person and have them walk on a crooked surface, they have problems. If I took two prisms and put them in front of your eyes and rocked them uniformly with a rhythm, you would wobble up and back. If I tilt the horizon, you would go to the left, then you go to the right. If I put binocular vision on a puppy with a periscope, so the sight level is 2 inches off the ground, a little dog looks like a big dog, and the dog will appropriately respond to that. If you make a distance look 4 times as deep as it is, an animal will stop at steps rather than attempt to go down. The brain is associated already with a certain perspective. If you produce that same thing in an optical device, a person will behave just as though they're 20 feet high, even though they're only 3 feet off the ground. They have to react to that. That's based on experience and associative memory. If you fill a person's brain and you tell them that the Greeks are responsible for all the world's problems today, if you do that over and over again, that's what propaganda is. Repeat of the same thing over and over again. Your ability to discriminate between propaganda and reality, you have no training in school. You're trained in patriotism. You're not trained in different people have different points of view due to their difference of upbringing. Now, if you train people that way, you can't control them. That's why we're trained a certain way, because we live in a civilization, although I use the word civilization, we are not civilized yet. Being civilized is knowing where to look, what to accept, what to reject as highly improbable. If somebody says, Jesus is coming tomorrow morning, that's highly improbable, because people talked about the end of the world coming. Years and years back, it never came. So they say, I had the wrong dates. The moon was not in the right place. Well, you can invent all kinds of things. You have to learn how to say, what I've heard seems to me highly improbable. It may be probable, but if you don't have the tools to evaluate it, if a surgeon talks to a layperson about new techniques in surgery, they can't always understand that because they don't have the background that that person has or the doctor has to talk to you. If you talk about new inventions in electronics, and the person has no experience in the field at all, you make assumptions. First thing you do is you say, do you know anything about electronics? You know what a resistor is? You know what a transformer is? No. Then you have to tell them that. Then you can go into things. So some people, even though you deliver genuine information, if they don't have the background to assimilate it, you're talking to yourself. Or sometimes you might talk to people about human behavior for a little while, then you say to them, are you interested in that subject? They say, not particularly. Then get off. But if you come at people and say, are you familiar with the Venus Project? No. Are you interested in social change? Are you interested in a world without war? No, not particularly. I'm interested in me. So that means don't bother. They're not interested. If they inquire into things, you tell them a little bit and say, what do you think I mean? And they come up with something entirely different, and repeat it another way, till you get the same meaning, because all people will react, not to you, to their background. So whenever you disappoint another person, it's never the other person. It's your expectations that are wrong. If you want to use words like right and wrong, which I don't ordinarily use. Yeah, you don't allow for differences in background. You figure I told the person, therefore they should understand. They don't understand. It means you didn't tell them anything. or sometimes you do tell them things, but the ego trip gets in the way. Now I want to tell you something. You spoke your words, now I'll speak mine. Sharing. You know, a lot of people believe in equal participation, although they may not have the qualifications for equal participation. Or they don't understand your use of language. I don't say that psychologists and psychiatrists don't arrive at some truths, some actual things they do, but they don't have a clear picture of what it is that shapes behavior. They say, when life hits you like that, you hit it back. Take hold of yourself. You ever hear that? Take hold. Use your head. Think. You can't. If the guy says, my landing gear doesn't come down, ask a psychiatrist, what do you suggest you do to make the landing gear come down? So I don't know anything about airplanes. Well, you don't know anything about behavior either. If you just say, when life hits you like that, you hit it back. That sounds good, makes you feel comfort, but it doesn't work. You can't hit life back. You can understand it, or you can understand where a person's coming from. But psychiatry is, why do you hate your mother, you know? Or you have a compulsion neurosis. What's that? What's a compulsion neurosis? There's no such thing as a compulsion neurosis. Or the person is inattentive. It means that what you have to say doesn't get to them at all, so they wander while you're talking. But if he says, how would you like a bag of candy? Most kids would be very attentive. Or would you like an ice cream cone? Yes. Would you like to spend a day in prison? Well, that's not interesting. So unattentive people are usually not interested in your subject, or they're brought up not to be interested in your subject. Or they have a value system that clashes with their outlook. So all of us are inattentive. If you took an intelligent person, a doctor, and you began to talk about how pickles are determined ripe in the pickle factory, they may not be interested in that, so they pay less attention to it. If you say there's some three new great developments in medicine, they lean forward because they're doctors. But if they're shoemakers, they don't lean forward. But if you say a new way to put shoes together faster, and a new glue that holds leather together, they may lean forward. So everybody is inattentive to some subjects. Otherwise, everybody would be a generalist. You understand? But if you say the trouble with you is you're inattentive, that does not inform anybody about anything. It just informs them about your rejection of their behavior. And without giving them anything, you leave them in midair. Or the trouble with you, my wife, is you don't always cook the things I like. Well, apparently you haven't made it clear, or she doesn't give a damn. And that's something for you to decide. So everybody is inattentive to certain subjects. If I give you a big fat book on women's garments, there's not a thing in there that a certain person would read. If he's a bricklayer, he doesn't give a damn about those things. So the trouble with him is, he's inattentive. Everybody is inattentive to some area. You go to the gun club, and talk about hydrodynamics, the pumping of fluids, they fall asleep. Talk about guns, they all wake up, because they have mono interest, or limited interest. And then you say, what the trouble with you is, you're not interested in hydrodynamics. Well, that doesn't make them interested in hydrodynamics. People only become interested in something that is relevant to their value system. So if you talk to 20 people and nothing happens, bunch of dummies. No, they're not. They're hooked in a certain value system and your expectations do not fit that circumstance. So when I say we talk at people, when people come here, I try to find out where they're coming from. If they're the women's club and fashion club, I might talk to them about Veblen's work in fashion and how it got to be. Then they would question their own field. You understand? If you teach people, even if they're in the fashion, you can alter them by starting with fashion. And if they're architects, you start out with, what is a shelter? Well, a shelter is a home that people live in. Well, a shelter is a space suit out in space. That's a shelter. Within it is an atmosphere. You can defecate, you wear diapers in a spacesuit, you can urinate because there's something to catch the urine. So that's a shelter. What is a shelter? When you go underwater, you wear a diving suit. You bring with you your environment under the water, because you can't live underwater. So when we have a fixed definition of a shelter, it's a house with a pointy roof. All our notions about anything is part of indoctrination. So when you say, yes, but what about thinking for yourself? You can't do that unless you've lived in other cultures, have read different kinds of books, have been exposed to sociology, anthropology, and understand that different people have different reactions to the same thing. The trouble with you is you're inattentive. That doesn't work. Ask them if they're interested in what you're talking about. Apparently your mother is not interested in what you talk about. And she can't even hear it because she looks at you as a strange person interested in things that don't count. What really counts? That's very difficult to ask a person whether they're into semantics. Of course they're not. They wouldn't come up with those questions. That's why a lot of people say, it seems to me, which is much better, it seems to me that we're moving in the wrong direction. It doesn't mean that it's moving out. It seems to me is good. Or, I believe that. That's all right. I believe that the person misbehaves, but I don't know why. That's rarely do people speak like that. If they don't speak like that, they never use terms like, it seems to me, or I feel it's highly probable. They don't speak that way. So you know who you're dealing with without asking them whether they've ever heard of semantics. I'm sure even if you talk to a semanticist, they have words like either or. You never say either or. But if you're on a precipice, if you take one step backwards, it's either or. There are either or conditions. So when the semanticist is trying to codify language into a fit it in their field, they sometimes negate it. Or they'd say, how do you feel about this construct? That's pretty good. You're inviting other people. Oh, you'll never see that due to human nature. Well, what is your meaning when you use the term human nature? Inborn patterns of human behavior. Like what? You say patriotism, is that inborn? You know, well, no, not that. They might understand that. So you have to show them. It's up to you to take their value system and dissect it and show them that it's not as useful as what have we here. I don't know. Let's check it out. That's a useful observation. The man is evil. There was a man, this is a true story I'm telling you. This guy used to get up every morning and the neighbor walked down the street. He used to say good morning and the neighbor never answered him. And he was a little disappointed in him. Years later he found out he was deaf. He never heard anything you guys said. This is true. So sometimes a person has their normal set of the face is a frown. He said, oh, sourpuss. You understand what I mean? That's a normal posture. And the old sourpuss, and everybody agrees. And the guy himself thinks he's an old sourpuss. People project like mad. Now, there's a difference between extrapolating and projecting. When you extrapolate, if you notice in cold weather, some trees begin to wither, and it gets colder, you can extrapolate that it's going to wither more. But projection is assuming things without any basis for that assumption. Except everyone has a right to their own opinion. That's not extrapolation. That's a repeat of a slogan. So our society is so wrapped up in irrelevancy, and that is a difficult problem. The more irrelevant the society, the more you have to work to convert them to another system. If that system does not appear useful to them, they will not hear it. So you have to package it so it appears useful. How would you like to get along with people and not get into fights? The guy Paul that used to work here, he used to, when somebody would insult him or hurt him, he'd be ready to fight. Now he says, he understands that if he fights, he can wind up in jail, he can injure the other person can injure him, he can be killed. So he doesn't fight, he says, anymore. He says, what used to make me angry and fight doesn't anymore. Getting into a physical fight, if a guy insults you, say you're nothing but a pinhead, He said, what did you say about me? You know, I was in a restaurant once eating, and a big guy came out and said, you're sitting in my chair. So I got up and let him have it. He was the kind of guy that would use force. So I said, that's right. He'd be called a bully on the other. You let that guy get you, move you out of that chair? Well, I'd tell him off. Well, you feel good telling him off. He's got a black eye, two teeth missing, and a brain injury. But you told him off. So what? And they say, boy, you're chicken, you're meek, you don't stand up for what you believe in. And that encourages soldiers, stand up for what you believe in. Get out there and fight. So they send you home in a plastic bag, in pieces. But you stood up for your beliefs. Nobody gives a shit about that. I'm saying in a nutshell that the world doesn't hurt people unless it's an earthquake. But most people are hurt by their expectations of others and the world. The world itself operates a certain way. As an earthquake, you maintain stability, get out of the building so it doesn't fall on you, or you get into a shelter that seems to be strong. That's more appropriate than saying, what the hell's the matter with nature? Or God will take care of me. Some guy fell off a tree with a chainsaw and only cut part of him. Says, Jesus protected me, I could have lost my arm. You can project your own vengeance. Jesus has nothing better to do than to watch billions of people at the same time and protect you. Really simplistic values. They are shockingly painful and dangerous. Through simplistic values, a person may want to kill you. Because you say you don't believe in Muhammad, and then therefore you don't believe in Allah, and Allah made everything on earth. You are evil. And if the person really believes that, he'll treat you like you're somebody that hurts him. And you are hurting him. So all these different things have to be taken into account. We can't anticipate the background of other people. There's nothing wrong with asking them, what's your favorite books? Whom do you admire? The Pope, whoever they tell you they admire, gives you some tool to work with. But if you just come at people, you're projecting the assumption that the person appears to be full grown, therefore they would understand. People know nothing until you do a survey of what have we here. Answer, I don't know. Then the survey. What are your favorite books? What kind of movies do you like? If you do that first, it's much easier than just coming at them. And you can't talk to people that say, I regret that I only have but two sons to give to my country. They both died in action, and I am a war hero from World War I. That person is not asking you, what do you think of an enemy nation? What is an enemy? He's not that person. He's a person that you would say, boy, I sure admire you for giving your two sons to the country. You know, that's what he wants to hear. That's part of the grammar of motives. You can't talk to certain people because they're not there to talk. They're there to have their rigid opinions verified. And you've got a hell of a lot of people. So you go to an American Legion meeting and talk about world unification. You stand much less of a chance than talking to the humanists. People don't think about that. They feel so sure of their own views that other people will understand them. Say, you guys are nuts, and they walk out. A very difficult job, unless they come to hear you, unless you identify with them. Especially if you get up and say, start out with, I'm Jewish, which is much easier. You know what I mean?
Yeah, we didn't mention that kind of thing, identifying with them first.
Yes, if you don't identify with them, I'm a member of the Boy Scouts of America, that's okay too. Or I'm a Greek, whatever, whoever you're talking to. When I went to Greece, I sang a Greek song, and they all
applauded. They loved it. He opened it by singing Semiotiso. Oh, they went crazy. We'll cut that now. We can go into some questions. Can technological unemployment in and of itself collapse the system?
Yes.
Are there any efforts involved in research and development of a technical plan that addresses the practicality of a resource-based economy, maybe something that addresses our current state and how to proceed?
I don't think so, unless you study something about energy determinants, how much energy it takes to accomplish a given task. It can only compare things to the energy required to accomplish a given task.
If not, any ideas on how to get this effort started? Talking about technical blueprints for a resource-based economy, I'm not sure what they're talking about. Are there any technical blueprints for a resource-based economy being developed?
Yes.
Okay, Jacques, why don't you write any material for mainstream, for example, a book on depression, tips, techniques, information, advice?
I can't do that because I don't have any credentials, and the book would not be widely accepted. It's like talking about Christianity in a Muslim country. The Muslim people already have a set regarding their beliefs. And it's very difficult. Unless they come to you and say, what is Christianity? What is an atheist? What is an agnostic? Not, what is an agnostic? Not an anger. If they ask questions, yes, you can answer them.
I'm concerned about the separation between the Zeitgeist movement and the Venus Project in regards to finding common ground between even those who agree with the ideals of a resource-based economy. Do you believe that this creates the conditions needed to create a resource-based economy? Anybody who wants to work on a resource-based economy with the Venus Project, the doors are open. I don't think that we're going to be joining the Zeitgeist movement to do anything in regards to what they're working with. We're working a bit in different directions. We don't have hostility to the members of the Zeitgeist movement. I'm not sure what else to say about that. Do you want to say anything about that?
Yeah, the Zeitgeist movement does not have a blueprint for any aspects of attaining a resource-based economy. They are people who point out the shortcomings of our present culture and let different people come in and make suggestions as to which way to go. I don't understand that. I would understand it if they had a procedural system for attaining a resource-based economy, but it has to be based on a system that's already been worked out. They can't just sit back and say, let's do this or let's do that. We could not work with the Zeitgeist movement because they merely pointed out the shortcomings of our culture and had nothing to do with how to attain a resource-based economy. I did say that if you wish to know more about it, read our books, look at our tapes, look at our website, so you pick up more information as to how it operates. Without that, there's just no communication.
In one of your videos, you said that potatoes give propensity towards alcoholism. What do you mean by that? And can you point out a research on it?
No, I can't remember, but I read that in a journal on health. And I read that the Irish people that tend to drink more alcohol was due to the heavy diet of potatoes. I never went into it. I never looked at it in detail. I just remember that.
I'm not exactly sure about this question, but I guess he's saying, how do you condition people when talking to them? Do you question them back?
Yes, to see if they understand what you mean. Give them a chance to counteract your statements. And then, if you have a procedural system, you use the best knowledge that you have to address the problems you face. But the best knowledge can only be attained if you check on most experiments that have proven certain things. Of course, you have to know what the shortcomings are of experiments. Not all experiments arrive at the same conclusions. Your ability to decipher that which is more relevant or less relevant has to do with your background.
Are you familiar with the film The Secret? It tells of the energy space, about that our thoughts are material and connected with the cosmos. What do you think about it? as I remember too, a little bit about the secret, they talked about if you manifest what you want in your thoughts, it will come about, if I remember that correctly.
I have no identification with that film. There's nothing in it that made sense to me.
What type of food diet do you eat, or do you have to recommend? What is the most optimal diet?
I would answer that by saying organically grown foods would probably be the most efficient for the human body. And it would eliminate a great many problems, because to grow a cow or an animal takes a lot of food. And you can feed more people if you don't use, if you use a vegetarian organically grown food, you stand less of a chance of contracting disease. If the food has artificial coloring or genetically altered, we don't know enough about it. There's not enough time that has been devoted to research in that area. So I would stay away from genetically altered food and chemically treated food and artificial coloring and flavoring. Conclusions I arrived at. It doesn't make it correct. I'm just telling you what I accept in that area. A lot of work to do in that area to arrive at more appropriate decisions.
We had the question about prohibited herbs and stuff like that. How do you plan to handle stuff like alcohol, cigarettes, and prohibited drugs?
They won't be available.
In a resource-based economy?
In a resource-based economy, detrimental things would not be available. You couldn't buy hot dogs or cigarettes, they would not be made. And people that are addicted to that would be treated with the best knowledge we have for treating such addiction. I'm just trying to help people understand what makes them act the way they do. Instead of getting angry at a person, I look at them differently. I say, they don't have the tools to understand, or I'm using tools that do not register with them. In other words, if I go to a Ku Klux Klan meeting, I can't come at them with my values. They wouldn't understand it. So I have to alter my values and give very primitive examples. And if they begin to understand, then you can become more elaborate with the passing of time. The degree of information that you present depends on how much they've learned.
I guess we'll wrap it up for today then.
Yes, thank you for all your efforts that you put out. And thanks for the opportunity to be able to answer some of your questions.
Yeah, we really appreciate everybody's work towards the film that just came out too, the new documentary, how they're helping to spread it around, and everything else that you're doing. It's a real pleasure working with everyone.
Yes, I agree with that.
Yeah. Trying to change the world is a pleasure.
It's a great adventure.
Thank you. That was very helpful.
Hopefully we'll see you next week.